prophet on the left is just an unknown male prophet by Jacob Pins from 1973. And the prophet on the right is actually meant to portray the prophet Jeremiah, and that was done by Joseph Lutko in 1930. So now I'm going to introduce Dr. Ashley Bacci, who will be presenting today. Dr. Bacci has presented at academic conferences around the country and around the world, including the European Association for Jewish Studies, the Society of Biblical Literature and the Mediterranean Studies Association. She has participated in archaeological excavations in Italy and has published in journals such as Zootope, Perspectives on Jewish Culture, and the Journal of the Bible and Its Reception. With a background in classics, Dr. Bacci brings an interdisciplinary approach to reading and contextualizing Second Temple Jewish literature, specifically Hellenistic Jewish literature. Her dissertation, which she completed at the Graduate Theological Seminary in 2015 and is under review for publication at Brill, is titled Uncovering Jewish Creativity, Gender and Intertextuality in Book 3 of the Sibling Oracles. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Ashley Bacci.
Today I am flanked by images of male prophets from the Magnus collection. They look as most of us would imagine, older men, beards, with a somewhat tortured air about them, either in their face or their demeanor. So what comes to mind when we think of a Greek prophetess? Perhaps Michelangelo's sibyls that sit opposite the Hebrew prophets in the Sistine Chapel? For example, here's Jeremiah, who sits opposite the Libyan sibyl. Do these sibyls have anything to do with the prophets they face? Initially, you may not think so. But in fact, some Hellenistic Jewish writers use the voice of the sibyl to deliver their prophetic message. These writings are part of what is called the Jewish pseudepigrapha. The pseudepigrapha consists of texts which were attributed to famous figures from the distant past, but were written by anonymous Jewish and then later Christian authors dating from the 2nd century BCE to the 2nd century CE. Biblical personages such as Enoch, Ezra, and Baruch were used to give authority to the contemporary concerns of the unnamed authors. The choice of the Greek sibyl for the Jewish author does not fit the typical model of pseudepigraphal literature, which uses a biblical character, obscure or otherwise, and creates a corpus that is validated in some way by its link to the Hebrew scriptures. Here, if you're interested in any of this literature, it's available in a two-volume set with Charles I argue the Jewish Sibylline Oracles draws creative inspiration from the Hebrew prophetic tradition, as well as Greek literature and culture, resulting in a unique voice that challenges both aspects of each culture. First, I will briefly discuss Hellenistic Jewish literature, and then I will demonstrate some of the ways Jewish Sibylline literature draws inspiration from the Hebrew prophets, as well as how it represents Hellenistic innovation and creativity. Lastly, I will briefly discuss how the Sibylline Oracles weave both Greek and Jewish tradition together to create a new mythos of the past, present, and future of the world. Hellenistic Jewish literature has become a point of intersection for classicists, ancient historians, and archaeologists, as well as biblical scholars. But this type of scholarship is still in its infancy, due to the previous marginalization of Hellenistic period in the field of classics as well as biblical studies. Classics as a discipline traditionally focused on archaic and classical Greek texts, which were viewed as the golden age of Greek literature. The golden age ended with Alexander the Great, and Hellenistic Judaism was viewed as a derivative and inconsequential in comparison, a product of a decadent age. Roman Latin literature was seen as the next influential body of work that drew inspiration from Greek Golden Age writers while still offering something new. This marginalization in classics was mirrored by the marginalization of the Hellenistic period in biblical studies. Before the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, many Hellenistic Jewish texts were dismissed as marginal abnormalities of contested nature between the pillars of Hebrew Bible and rabbinic literature. After the Dead Sea Scrolls proved the antiquity of these texts and solidified the diverse nature of Second Temple Jewish literature, they were re-examined for their role in the history of Judaism as well as nascent Christianity. Christian scholars looked to these texts as the precursor to New Testament messianic mentalities and the rise of apocalyptic imagery, eventually resulting in their classification as intertestamental literature. The reception of these texts has been a journey of marginalization and slow acceptance that has recently brought them to be acknowledged as more than just a bridge between the Hebrew Bible and rabbinics, or the Hebrew Bible and the New Testament. These texts are now approached as a body of literature that reflect a range of perspectives, many of which did not survive the canonization of thought in either Christian or Jewish tradition. They offer insight into the varied experience and diversity of Hellenistic Judaism. In order to understand these texts, we need to see them as operating as part of the overarching phenomena of Hellenistic culture. From this standpoint, it becomes evident that it's just as relevant, if not more so, for this literature to be examined by classicists and ancient historians as it is by scholars of the Hebrew Bible, New Testament, and rabbinics. Israelite prophecy was traditionally approached as reaching a peak in the monarchic period, declining in the post-exilic period, and over by the Second Temple period. In the late 1980s and early 1990s, this perspective was questioned and is now viewed as highly problematic. Pseudepigraphal texts acted as a conduit for Second Temple writers to prolong the age of prophecy, as they used figures of authority from the past to offer hope for the future. The following will discuss the prophetic nature of the Jewish Sibyl and compare how she is prepared in relation to the Hebrew prophets. I argue the Jewish author offers a new voice of gendered prophecy, but does so within a framework based on the accepted traditional models of Jewish prophecy. The oldest stratum of the Sibylline oracles are collected in Book 3 and date to the 2nd century BCE. On the surface, the Sibylline oracles look as the authors intended. They look like Greek oracles. They're an example of Greek hexameter poetry, like Homer's epics, the Iliad and the Odyssey. But instead of a continuous narrative, they are a conglomerate of oracles. Note that because the text is a conglomerate, a collection of oracles were written by more than one author, which is why sometimes I will speak of plural authors, while others I will refer to a singular author if it is regarding one particular author within the text. The oracles primarily prophesy the end of the world and some discussion of its beginnings as well as the present. The text rejects Greek genealogies of the Sibyl and states her true identity. She is the daughter-in-law of Noah. She is the prophetess of the one true God, and her words will prove to be true. She learned of the beginning of the world from Noah, and God told her of its end. The Sibyl becomes a liminal figure, a part of a tradition older than the divide between cultures, able to function in the past, present, and future, allowing the Jewish author to speak from a place of authority in both traditions. While one can argue that the characteristics of male Hebrew prophets, such as their ability to perform miracles or lengthy orations, are ancillary traits to being a prophet, one attribute that is afforded to male prophets that is not afforded to female prophets, identifying it as Neviah in Hebrew, such as Miriam, Deborah, and Huldah, is critical. God speaks directly to male prophets, and they speak on behalf of God. Esther Fuchs discusses the fragmentary and ambiguous descriptions of Neviah in the Hebrew Bible and argues the narrator intentionally used the messenger formula, like God spoke to Jeremiah, to dramatize and confirm the interactions with male prophets, but to not use the messenger formula or describe any verbal dialogue between God and female prophets in order to suppress their authority. For instance, Miriam is described as a Nibia, but her prophecy is expressed through dance and song, thus performative rather than verbal prophecy. The Sibyl, on the other hand, is characterized by her verbal prophecy and receives revelation directly from God through embodied inspiration, i.e. physical takeover, and mental inspiration, i.e. knowledge delivered directly into the mind. The Sibyl is not described as a disembodied abstract voice. She is a woman that is physically affected by her role as a prophet. In fact, the Sibyl remarks on the physically draining nature of prophecy twice. I entreat you to give a little rest to me who have prophesied unfailing truth, for my heart is tired within. But why does my heart shake again? Why is my spirit lashed by a whip, compelled from within to proclaim an oracle to all? And again, and I entreat the great begetter that I might have respite from compulsion. The prophet Jeremiah also discusses the draping bodily effects of prophecy. For example, Jeremiah 29, I thought I will not mention him, no more will I speak in his name. But his word was like a raging fire in my heart, shut up in my bones, I could not hold it in, I was helpless. This sets the Sibyl's bodily response to access to divine inspiration within established limits of Jewish prophetic experience. The former prophets, the narrative books of Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings, are characterized by confronting individual kings, while the latter prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and the 12 minor prophets, are characterized by addressing the collective behavior of nations. Hebrew female prophets do not address either. The Sibyl again stands out in this differentiation between male and female prophecy, because the Sibyl addresses the ethical behavior of nations in the same vein as the latter and minor prophets. For example, the Sibyl's oracles against nations in Book 3 are analogous to summary versions of Isaiah chapters 10, 12, and 19. Descriptions of God's judgment and idyllic transformation of the end times correspond to those in Isaiah, Ezekiel, and Zechariah. For example, Isaiah 11 describes, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard lie down with the kid, the calf, the beast of prey, and the fatling together with a little boy to herd them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion like the ox shall eat straw. In the Sibylline Oracles, Book 3, you have, wolves and lambs will eat grass together in the mountains. Leopards will feed together with kids. Roving bears will spend a night with calves. The flesh-eating lion will eat husks at the manger like an ox, and mere infant children will lead them with ropes. It is logical for a Jewish writer wishing to be accepted in an established prophetic tradition to model their work on traditional topics as presented by prophetic figures such as Isaiah, Ezekiel, and Zechariah. The authors were so successful that gender has been a non-category in studies of the Sibylline Oracles, because her prophecy is not different from what we would expect from a Jewish male prophet. This actually makes the issue of gender all the more important, because it gives us information from the perspective of the Jewish authors. They did not feel it would be taboo to use a female voice for a traditionally male form of prophecy. But if they did, they could have chosen from a choice of Greek male oracles, such as Bacchus, who's often paired with the Sibyl in Greek texts. The Sibyl was given the freedom to have a direct relationship with God and the power to address nations that prophetesses such as Miriam, Deborah, and Huldah were not given. Gender offers another level to the liminality of the Sibyl as a Jewish pseudonym. She not only offers a persona that can hold both Greek and Jewish traditions simultaneously, but she is a female that is allowed to prophesy in the same manner as a male. As mentioned earlier, the Sibyl claims to be the daughter-in-law of Noah. Michael Stone has discussed the importance of Noah in an attempt to contextualize the transmission of teachings in Dead Sea Scroll texts, such as Jubilees, Aramaic, Aramaic Levi visions of Amram within a priestly Noachic tradition. He states, quote, Noah is the second Adam and the founder of post-diluvian humanity. Conjunctions and disjunctions with the antediluvian period are stressed. The continuity of a tradition, the new order of the world, and the shortened lives, as well as the origins of the demons from the giants. The sudden clustering of works around Noah indicates he was seen as a pivotal figure in the history of humanity, as both an end and a beginning. End quote. The Sibyl as daughter-in-law of Noah plays into this cycle of the history of humanity. The primary message of the Jewish sibling oracles is to warn the world of the coming final judgment, and Book 3 presents universal history as a succession of kingdoms. The theme of universal history is first attested in Greek texts, such as Hesiod's Theogony, which orders history through a series of ages. Arnaldo Mimigliano outlined the development of the use and practice of the universal history theme and points out that Greek historians primarily developed three variations of the succession of world empires, depending on political motivations. Different metals representing different races, the life cycle of childhood, youth, maturity, and old age, and evolution through technological advances from barbarism to civilization. The Jewish tradition of universal history expands this framework of time by providing past history as well as apocalyptic visions of the future. Mimigliano observed that the writer of the Book of Daniel adopted the Greek notion of world empires and made it the groundwork for a messianic age. Quote, while using the Greek notion of the succession of empires to illuminate the ways of God, he had also produced a quaint target for the destructive capacities of God. End quote. No empire would be immune to the time of judgment. The kingdom of God would reign supreme. The Greek theme of universal history focused on contemporary reflection of past history for the understanding of the present status of mankind. This theme was redirected to an anticipation of the final kingdom of God when it was appropriated by Jewish authors. Scholars have pointed out that moral exhortations were a new facet of Jewish sibylline prophecy, a feature that was grounded in the style of the Hebrew prophets. It is through moral exhortation that the Jewish Sibyl was able to offer a path to redemption, which is seen also in Daniel, 4th Ezra, and 1st Enoch. Eric Gruen discusses the Jewish Sibyl, how the Jewish Sibyl reached out to Greeks because, quote, preparation for the eschaton can unite Hebrew and Hellene alike. The emphasis on the Jewish Sibylline tradition had shifted to future judgment, and although the Greeks and other nations are condemned for idolatry and other sins, there is also a call for repentance and promise of redemption. We have briefly discussed how the Jewish Sibyl presents Hebrew prophetic themes. Now we'll discuss how Greek themes are presented. I will note that sections of Book 3 that discuss Greek myth have traditionally been approached by scholars as paraphrases made by Jewish authors of lost authentic Greek sibylline oracles. While Jewish authors incorporated, which Jewish authors incorporated to make the text appear genuine. The Greek myths and cultural references have various differences to the standard Greek narratives, and these disparities are often dismissed as unintentional mistakes made by the Jewish author because they didn't know any better. The subject matter was something other to them. I argue the Jewish Sibylline oracles represent an original synthesis of Greek and Jewish reference that would have been available to elite 2nd century BCE Hellenistic Jews. And the narrative changes were indeed intentional and act as an example of appropriation for the purpose of demonstrating mastery of Greek tradition by subverting and reinventing it to align with Jewish monotheistic sensibilities. So let's take a look at one of the Greek myths that's reimagined in the Jewish Sibylline oracles. I'll give a brief summary of the Greek cosmology from Hesiod's Theogony, which depicts the beginning of the world as a series of generational struggles. Uranos, the sky, or heavens, rests on top of Gaia, the earth, impregnating her, yet never allowing her the space to give birth. their children trapped inside her. The youngest Kronos, youngest son, Kronos, takes a sickle created by his mother Gaia and castrates Uranus, who, of course, jumps back and allows space between the earth and the sky. It is through this recoiling that the children trapped beneath the earth are allowed free. The next generation of the gods, the Titans, known as Tithonic deities because they're connected to the earth. Kronos, as leader of the Titans, feared his children would usurp him as he did his father, so he then ate his children, born from his sister wife Rhea, until he was tricked and given a rock instead of his youngest son Zeus, who in turn split Kronos down the middle, releasing his siblings and the next generation of the gods, the Olympians. Book 3 of the Sibling Oracles has its own 45-line rendition of this narrative, but reassigns the divinity of these foundational Greek gods to the role of mortal kings. The idea originates in the writings of Euhemerus of Messene in the 4th century BCE and his travel account entitled Sacred Record. The narrative in Book 3 appears to be inspired by this travel account by Euhemerus, and as well as Hesiod's Theogony and Homeric vocabulary from the Iliad. The Sibylline Titan account acknowledges that Uranus and Gaia were known as heaven and earth, but states that they received these appellations, quote, because they were the first of articulate men, end quote. While Hesiod presents an Uranus who is oppressive to his partner Gaia and his children and is eventually castrated by his youngest son, Kronos, the Sibylline account presents Uranus as keeping order and dividing the earth evenly between his three sons, Kronos, Titan, and Iapetus, by drawing lots. The sons in the Sibylline account rule their respective portions without fighting because of an oath they made to their father until his death. Scholars have argued that the division of land would be reminiscent of Genesis's account of dividing the land between Noah's sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. I argue this should be coupled with the allusion to the division of the world between Zeus, Poseidon, and Hades by the drawing of lots in the Iliad Book 15, a scene unique in Greek literature until it is brought up again by the Hellenistic writers Callimachus and Apollodorus. It is important to note here that a characteristic of Hellenistic poetry has proven to be a battleground of wits between poets, a platform on which to demonstrate to fellow poets how clever and well-read they were in comparison to others by incorporating obscure references from traditional material like Homer and Hesiod, as well as engaging with contemporaries like Callimachus. Callimachus led the rise of Homeric scholarship in the Alexandria Museum in the 3rd century BCE, and he was also one of the trendsetters for Hellenistic poetry. Callimachus wrote 6 hymns modeled on the Homeric hymns, and in his hymn to Zeus, Callimachus criticizes the tradition that the world was divided between the gods by lots. In his criticism of the description of division by lot, Callimachus prays that he had the ability to tell lies as well as Homer, because there is no other possible reason for people to believe that anyone would be foolish enough to draw lots for such an important prize. With this in mind, the reference to the Jewish Sibylline Titan account to the division of the world by lot demonstrates the author's knowledge of Homer while also engaging with Callimachus, a more contemporary text. The author turns Callimachus's critique against Greek tradition to say that not only are the Greek gods mortal, but they would in fact be foolish enough to divide the world by lots. The sibling Kronos does nothing harmful to his children. They are hidden by Rhea, but this is because Kronos pledged to his brother Titan not to have any male heirs. The sibling text removes the patriarchs Uranus and Kronos from any accountability in reference to acts that in Hesiod warranted neo-patricidal retaliation. Rather than a tension between father and son, the struggle for power is presented between brothers. Fraternal struggle is common characteristic of tensions in the Hebrew Bible. For example, Cain and Abel, Isaac and Ishmael, Jacob and Esau, Joseph and his brothers. A final example to demonstrate how the Jewish author understood, acknowledged, and reimagined Greek tradition to create a sophisticated critique of Greek ritual is the Titan account's description of the birthplace of Pluto. The Sibylline account states that Pluto is born as Rhea passed Dodona near Stygian waters. It says, "Further the third time, Rhea, marvel of women, bore Pluto as she went past Dodona, whence the watery paths of the river Europas flowed, and the water ran to the sea, mingled with the Pineus, and they called it Stygian." Pluto's birthplace by the river Styx connects him to his respective underworld realm. Dodona was famous in the ancient world as a cult center for Zeus. Jane Lightfoot points out that it was this famous ancient cult center that was mentioned in Iliad's catalog of ships, alongside the river Tartarus and the Peneus. And the mention of the Styx, the author of the Sibylline account may have used this as the source for connecting these place names. Quote, "Dodona is obviously the cult place of Zeus, as the Iliad makes amply clear. Though the Sibyl prefers to make it the birthplace of Hades, one wonders whether this is a jab at the famous pagan cult center, implying that the god of Dodona is, in fact, the god of the dead, in parallel to other Jewish jibes against pagan gods in Hades," end quote. The Sibylline account does not mention the river Tartarus and makes Dodona the source of the Europa, both of which are departures from Homeric geography. Lightfoot understands this as an indication that the author was unfamiliar with Homeric geography. Rather than being an indication of a lack of Homeric geographical knowledge, I argue these geographical references were specifically chosen to create a nuanced polemic against the Greek pantheon. The river Styx is traditionally located in Arcadia. The location in the Sibylline account points to the general location of Mount Olympus in Thessaly, past Dodona and the river near the river Pineus. In fact, today you can take a whitewater rafting tour. This is the Pineus here. This is Mount Olympus. And you can take a whitewater rafting tour along the Pineus to the foothills of Mount Olympus. This creates a parallel between the home of the Greek pantheon on Mount Olympus and the entrance to the land of the dead. The Sibylline Titan account would then be affording the gods of the Greek pantheon the status of mere mortals, as well as cleverly juxtaposing the home of the Olympian gods with the underworld. This reflects knowledge not only of Greek literature, but cultic centers as well. The location and reputation of Mount Olympus would have been common knowledge in the Mediterranean world. Thus, this type of geographical misdirection would have presented a clever critique that the path of Greek divinity resides in the underworld. Callimachus' hymn to Zeus, which I mentioned earlier, states that the Arcadian rivers were the result of Rhea giving birth on Mount Lycian and the need for water to clean at the afterbirth. George McLennan discusses how this digression is meant to display Callimachus' geographical expertise. While the Sibylline author does not utilize this particular reference, I argue the Jewish author was inspired to use a competitive geographical notation within the Titan account. The Sibylline author's subversive use of Homeric geography for the birth of Pluto near Dodona and Stygian waters would effectively make Callimachus' model for displaying geographical expertise seem basic in comparison. A perfect example of the Hellenistic literary quest of one-upmanship. In conclusion, the Sibylline oracles are creative Jewish expressions of hybrid cultural identity that integrates both Hebrew prophetic models and Greek oracular styles and motifs, showing a complex spectrum of acceptance, rejection, and adaptation that challenges both traditions, whether that be breaking the traditional divides between male and female prophetic models, or by critiquing Greek religious narrative and cult sites by using current Hellenistic styles of expression to prove mastery through subordination. Thank you. Volume set of the Jewish pseudepigrapha. These texts have all of what we have currently, I mean not all, but translated texts of the pseudepigrapha in general. So there's the books of Enoch, Jubilees. Within that, there's also the Sibylline Oracles. Book 3 is the oldest, but they were compiled into books 1 through 12. There's some, the textual transmission has labeled what is the oldest as a later book. I won't get into all the textual transmission because it's kind of a very dry manuscript situation, but we know from the vocabulary used and from the references to events that book 3 is dated to about the 2nd century BCE. So it's the oldest. The others, we have some that are written by Christian authors later. We have some that are written in the closer to the end of the turn of the century that are Jewish and Christian writers. But book 3 is the oldest, has the oldest material.
And appears to be on the surface Jewish, or you could you tell that you just started reading it?
Yes.
Yes.
So the question is, could you tell that they're Jewish? They are written in epic hexameter verse in Greek. So on the surface, if you were to look at them, you would not think automatically that they were Jewish. But once you read them, they are written from a monotheistic perspective, proclaiming the superiority of Jewish culture, and have a series of oracles against nations, condemning idolatry, condemning various behaviors, ethical behaviors. So the content shows the perspective. They are also extremely Hellenistic. They are a part, they're my argument and the way in which approach Hellenistic Jewish texts is that they're not divorced from the larger Hellenistic trends, literary trends, architectural trends, but they're participating within that culture. So the authors were classically trained. They felt very comfortable. They had to be very comfortable with Greek, the language, in order to write such sophisticated oracles. Because it's not a simple genre. It's not prose. It has rules. Actually, one of the points that I make is that not only is it in the style, Hellenistic literary style, but they hyper-archaicize certain aspects of their work to evoke Homer all the more in their style, in stylistically. So in content, most of them it's very, you would read it, and if you read it in translation, it's, you would say, yes, this is a Jewish perspective on ethical behavior. And then in form, and also in influence stylistically, it would be very Greek. So it's a blending of both.
Is there any indication that they were written by a woman? Or women?
Yes, so there's no way to tell. I would say that as of right now, it's highly unlikely, because the level of education for the style of writing would be the very upper crust elite. And while there are very well-educated women in the ancient world and in the Hellenistic period as well, and there may be pseudepigraphal texts that are written at least in part by women, and it's not to say that it's impossible that some of the oracles were written by women, but I find it more likely that it was written by an elite Jewish man in the second century who was surrounded by powerful women and surrounded by depictions of powerful women around him. This is a writer in Alexandrian Egypt. You have powerful queens. There's dedications to those queens, and we have a lot of Hellenistic literature where women are the focus. And it was not against his sensibility to feel that it would be impossible for a prophetic voice to be feminine. So I'm not discounting it, but there's no way to know. Yes.
In what context would this have been read or listened to? Any liturgical context, or would this have been for a study group or a literary performance?
So the question is about context. What context would these oracles have been discussed? I don't think they would have a liturgical aspect to it. It would be too, although it has the prophetic models, it's not one in which I think would lend itself to liturgy. I do think that the Hellenistic age was a time of great scholarly discussion. So you have the rise of the museums, the scholarly museums. You have the proliferation of writing that previously was more oral, but now it's being written in papyri. And so you have what is the origins of our kind of academic schools, as you would imagine them today. And I imagine these oracles being written by Hellenistic Jewish poets that are showing how they can, their mastery of this poetic model. And they are in conversation with other Hellenistic writers. So I don't think that they're sequestered off just because they're Jewish academics. I think that they're part of the lively academic life of Alexandrian culture. And so if we look at the larger literary movement, the ways in which there is discussion is very much participating in the same ways that other Hellenistic poets are writing, in that there's very obscure reference uses of Hapax legomena, so like something that's only used once, referenced once in Homer or something, and then a Hellenistic poet would want to show that they knew that that was only referenced once by bringing it into their own poetry so that it would create a memory, it would evoke a memory for the reader. for a highly intellectually readership. There were these types of kind of dialogues happening, and I have identified how the Jewish author, the Jewish authors of the Sibylline oracles, particularly focusing on the text, the oracles that use Greek myth primarily, and that were seen as too other to be Jewish, to be so looked at as paraphrases or something, something a little bit too uncomfortable to be written by a Jewish author completely. I focused on those narratives and shown how they're participating in that literary culture to promote a monotheistic sensibility.
So perhaps written by a connoisseur or connoisseurs?
I would say for an elite, to an elite, and for to show that that there's no, not only can you play with the other poets, but that you're better. Yes and yes.
And I think that's it.
Yeah. Frida?
So I was wondering, because you say that this work shows these elements from both culture weaving together, cultural acceptance, adaptation. But what my feeling from your talk is that it's mostly rejection of the Greek myth and religion. And so basically, it's written in Greek because probably it goes for the Greek audience. But the main element is the way of persuading, indeed, that the Jewish thought was probably superior about God and the things he faced. So I wonder if instead there are other elements, other parts where you can really see a more acceptance, cultural acceptance from the Jewish side of the elements.
So the question. The question is that I've highlighted a lot of elements of rejection of the Greek tradition rather than the acceptance, and are there examples more of the acceptance rather than subordination of Greek culture? I would say that there's the fact that the Jewish author is not dismissing all the traditions, the Greek traditions that he's learned from Homeric tradition and from the ritual and cultural aspects of society that he's fully immersed in, that is in a way showing acceptance, because it's not one way of rejecting is to completely dismiss. So rather than saying, so you could give a Titan account, but you don't have to say that you knew that the Greeks thought of Uranus and Gaia as heaven and earth. You could just say, these are mortals. And so in the acknowledging the traditions, and there's conversation happening. So, and the Greek tradition in like oracles against nations, the Greeks in particular, there are some nations in which there's not a feeling of potential redemption. But for the Greek nations, there is a feeling of, you feel some solidarity. So it's your, if you can give up your idolatrous practice, you'll be protected by God in this time to come. So, and I would say that it's not straight rejection. I would also, in when there's this subverting techniques, I would say that Hellenistic poets in general are all writing like this. So they're referencing each other and saying, and I can do it a little bit better. And in this way, it's the Jewish author expressing how he can do it better. How he can take this tradition that he's around and that he acknowledges that he's been trained in and is his identity as well. So that's the point, is that he's not just Jewish, he's Greek. He's Greek and Jewish, and he has both of these traditions, and he wants them to not conflict with each other. So So how can we take all that I am immersed in and that is me and present it in a way that shows that how I'm accepting myself in some ways? So it's varying levels of negotiation, of cultural negotiation. Yes.
Did you read these in Greek or in translation?
Greek. I use the translations, Collins translation, because it's clearer, and then if you look at the pseudepigrapha, then that's what you would get.
Are these recent findings, or have they existed in cultures since they were written? Are they referenced?
Yes. So these were preserved in various texts. So because they were very successful in mastering the meter and the appearance of oracles, you have they're mentioned in Greek and Latin sources, and they're preserved by church fathers and patriarchs that use them as in the later Christian uses of the Sibyl. They really emphasize how she's an outsider, kind of, and giving validation to monotheistic sensibilities. But in book three, that's not the case, because she's incorporated into kind of a Jewish historical axis through her relationship with Noah. So that's something that's not been, it's discussed in one other book, and then it's really given, it's kind of repressed in the Christian oracles, because there is a desire to have an outside pagan witness to kind of monotheistic tradition.
I think
and you can come to me after.